The Republic of Tyva is situated in eastern Siberia. It is Asia's geographic center. This is a land of unusual landscapes and ancient traditions.
Tyva is a country of mountains. They cover 80% of its territory.
The people who lived here long ago were nomads. They came up with an alternative form of music called throat singing, which imitates the sounds of nature.
The most common style is called Khome.
Scientists say Tyvans are among Siberia's most ancient peoples. Their ancestors are believed to have settled here 30,000 years ago. Sean Quirk, a US citizen, drives an old Soviet car. He nicknamed it the Russian tank for its reliability both on and off road. Sean originally came to Tyva 8 years ago to study the local phenomenon of throat singing. He ended up staying in Kyzyl.
Turns out that I really like it here and I learned the language real quick. And next thing I know, I'm married and I got 3 children. I fell in love with my wife at the end of my Fulbright year, and that just sort of started the whole domino effect.
Sean is very attached to his car and he uses it constantly. He got used to long drives as a postman in his previous life in the United States.
Are you happy to see me?
The years since Sean Quirk came to Tyva have been eventful. He got married and fathered 3 children. He was also awarded the title of Tyva's People's Artist and started building a house for himself and his family. Tyva's capital, Kyzyl, is situated in the very heart of Asia. Elizabeth Gordon often visits its main square. 3 years ago, she came here from Australia to collect material for a thesis on women's throat singing in Tyva.
We are standing here in Square Arat, in the very centre of Kyzyl, one of my favourite places to come and meet with friends, go to see theatre productions and concerts at the main theatre here, come here every day to walk around the prayer wheel, as is the Buddhist tradition. It's such a beautiful place here.
Kyzyl's population is 100,000. The city is constantly growing and new houses are being built for the newcomers and newlyweds. Elizabeth has found a new home and a new life here. She's been living in the house of this Tyvan family for several years.
Hello, Anita.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm okay.
Elizabeth shares the same room with her Tyvan sister, Anita, who is 13 years old. They behave like real sisters, having real arguments sometimes.
Wash the dishes.
No, today you wash. I washed yesterday.
Yeah, and I was washing them today.
When?
All morning.
No, all morning I washed.
I don't think so. Well then, if I have to wash the dishes, then you wash the floor.
Girls, come here to have some tea.
Every evening, the family gets together over a cup of tea. For Elizabeth, who before only drank coffee, it became a new favourite tradition.
This is my Tyvan family, who I live with in Tyva. My mama, Hima, my papa, Orlan, my Tyvan papa, my little brother, Amir, very important, Amir, and my 13-year-old sister, Anita. I also have a similar family in Australia. Mother, father, of course, older sister, and my brother is the same age as Amir.
Tonight's tea party is all about Elizabeth's expedition. The next morning, she will set out on a trip where she hopes to take in the picturesque scenery of Tyva's West and meet musicians who share her interest in throat singing. The family gives her some advice. Kyzyl is a young city, no more than 100 years old, but there are ancient burial sites dotted all around it. Here, the people are able to draw on some unknown force. The locals believe this energy comes from the fact that 2 rivers meet. The the Mali Yenisei and the Balshoi Yenisei come together to form the Great Yenisei, one of Siberia's biggest waterways. Tyvans have many legends about it.
The mistress of the river is a beautiful young lady who rides a white horse made of water. We want to make a sculpture in her image so that we can honor our great provider, the Yenisei.
Kadir Olbechildey is head of the Tyvan Institute of Humanitarian Research. Today he's walking towards an image of Tyvan hunters in search of prey captured by an ancient artist thousands of years ago. Scientists have found such stone petroglyphs all across Tyva, especially around its capital, Kizil.
This is Kizil's oldest historical landmark. It's 7,000 or 8,000 years old. The important thing about it is the picture of hunters featuring deer and goats. There are more than 400 such stones in Kizil alone.
Several kilometers from Kizil lies Erbek Valley. The old riverbed of the Yenisei is nearby. Archaeologists are excavating a burial mound on top of a high hill. They have found many graves dating back to the Bronze Age. Those graves belonged to a simple people.
Excavation work has revealed structures with sophisticated geometry and very interesting burial techniques. Some of the elements could be described in modern architectural terms, such as arches, bracing, and masonry. All of them are of very good quality.
Scientists say the burial ground was unsealed many years ago. It may have been done to make room for a new site.
Most burials and mounds in Tyva have been pillaged, either in ancient times or by successive generations of impoverished people. They dug them up to try and get to the valuables.
All the musicians of Tyva hold this workshop in Kizil in high regard. It belongs to Aldar Tamdin. He is descended from a renowned family of craftsmen that make folk music instruments, and he sings too. Today, the craftsmen are busy with making an igil. The igil is one of Tyva's oldest instruments. Trees that grow in the Republic are used to produce it. They are thought to be filled with the spirit of the land.
You have to mark it with a pencil to make it right.
Any kind of musical instrument can be made here. Also, if it doesn't exist, it can be invented right here in this workshop. All you need is a tree and some creativity.
Poplar, larch, birch, or pine. It doesn't matter. Anything will do when you're making an igil. The secret is that we aren't bound by any rules. We don't care about standards. The instruments, they're works of art.
The people of Tyva have a distinct legend for each musical instrument. This one is called a chadagan.
A wife of a local respected man made this instrument after he threw her onto the street. She stretched animal guts and tendons over a washtub. There are instruments for hunters and shepherds, but this one suits homemade music best of all.
A valley 40 kilometers east of Kizil is popular with local shepherds. Here they often host musicians trying to recreate a horseback band of the kind that existed in the Tyvan People's Republic in the early 20th century.
Okay, let's try to approach the horses. Do it carefully.
The shepherds have picked horses for the musicians, but the animals still aren't used to the noise produced by the band. Even if horses have been trained beforehand, when they spend too many months on a pasture, they become out of touch with humans. Once the musicians lasso the horses, the next thing to do is to introduce them to musical sounds, gently at first.
Good boy, well done. He remembers me.
It takes the horses half an hour to get used to the sound produced by the band.
It's difficult to ride a horse and play a musical instrument at the same time, and there's a problem also with breathing. And of course, the horse can throw you on the ground. But today, everything actually seems to be okay. Ready! 1, 2, 3, 4.
As the musicians ride out of the enclosure, their drumbeat echoes throughout the valley.
Wow, this is a great view.
For the time being, Sean's family lives in a yurt, a dwelling made of thick felt. It is the kind used by nomads. His wife used to live here before meeting her future husband. Svetlana says Sean has changed his family's eating habits. American cuisine now holds pride of place in this Tyvan dwelling.
My husband has introduced traditional American food, notably spicy chili.
Sean Quirk is an amateur builder. He hammers nails and plasters walls. He's very excited to move from his small yurt to a bigger building, where there's more space for the kids. He jokingly calls it the house that Sean built.
What we have here is the, what could we call it? The Russian dream. We got a nice little log house made of Siberian larch wood, which is gonna be, stand for centuries. It doesn't rot, doesn't go anywhere, so we'll be done with this in a little while. Be a nice Russian home to stay in the winter. Now what we have over here, next door, to the Russian dream. We have the place we call the Tyvan dream. This is a yurt, which is a very high technology developed over thousands of years by the Tyvans and other nomadic people for dwelling in this climate. And this yurt's about 50 years old. It was given to me by my father-in-law. Right now it just looks like a pile of wood and a trailer, some boards, but this is gonna be where we have the Russo-Tuvinsko-Americo dream.
Sean needs to finish building his house before the onset of winter. So far, he has put up the walls and set the window frames. Fifty kilometers west of Kizil, the great Yenisei makes its way past mountains. In the 8th century BC, Uyghur troops used to have an observation post high up the cliffs. Nothing but a pile of flat rocks is left now. Elizabeth will take pictures during her expedition and send them back to Australia.
From the eastern side, you can see things dozens of kilometers away. It's easy to spot anything sailing down the Yenisei River.
Australian researcher Elizabeth Gordon and other members of the expedition have reached a remote shepherd camp in Tyva's west. Among the guests this time are Elizabeth's friends from a group of singers called the Daughters of Tyva.
Hi.
Hello.
Hello, nice to meet you.
Their hostess, Vera Bailak, is a legend in these parts. Among other things, she is the last surviving soldier from the Tyvan People's Army that fought in World War II. In accordance with local tradition, the inhabitants of a shepherd camp treat visitors to tea and chat with them. Nomads always treasure contact with visitors, as it is their way of hearing the news.
Granny, we'd like to give you a present by singing a traditional Tyvan song for you. Yeah.
The unique thing about the daughters of Tyva is that the young women use their throat singing technique during their performances. They also play traditional instruments.
I have lived here in this valley since I was a child. Performers are very rare visitors here. I am happy to have you here. It's a great present for someone as old as me. It makes me very happy.
Translated from the Tyvan language, this mountain, towering over the shepherd camp, is called Mount Heavenly Bear. Several years ago, the Dalai Lama came here. He declared that the mountain is a sacred symbol for the entire Buddhist world. Elizabeth is marveled by the landscape she sees here.
Scenery here is very different to anything that I have ever seen before. And although many people think that it is a very bare and very stark environment here, I think the starkness of it is actually very, very beautiful.
The Ustulkure Buddhist Temple is the final destination on the tour of Tyva's West. For many years, the complex of monasteries was regarded as a vivid example of Buddhist construction in the region. The temple was destroyed in 1937, at the height of a Soviet campaign against religion. The surviving walls of the temple mean as much to Tyvans as the Wailing Wall means to Jews. All visitors walk around the temple several times, and they offer prayers. Many people in Tyva are Buddhists, but they worship the ancient practice of shamanism at the same time. The shamans claim they have inherited their gift from their ancestors. Just like their fathers and grandfathers, they communicate with the spirits.
This place is charged with great energy. It brings strong protection and gives good luck.
Larissa Norbu is a famous sculptor in Tyva, but she believes she is cursed and needs the supreme shaman to help restore her artistic talent.
Let the blue skies, the golden sun, the silver moon and the stars give us eternal protection. Let your life be as white as milk.
Followers of shamanism say that their ritual is an offering to ancestral spirits. The spirits are believed to help people at the request of shamans as a token of gratitude for the food offered to the sacrificial bonfire. The shaman has to remove the curse and make Larissa feel better.
My eyes now see more clearly.
She's better now. I've removed the curse.
After the shamanic ritual, artist Larissa Norbu returns to the bank of the Yenisei. Here she hopes to find agalmatolite, a semi-precious stone that she wants to use to make a figurine of a particular Tyvan hero.
This is it. Now I'm going to make a dancer out of it.
Larissa Norbu began practicing her handicraft several years ago. The practice is believed to be an all-male occupation. But Larissa believes that female craftsmen are better at capturing the facial expressions on the figurines than men are.
I have a sense that I get help from someone. That's how I feel about it. From the outset, I have no idea how the faces or something will end up as. But as soon as I'm on track, things take care of themselves.
Today is just another busy day for Sean. He's been driving home from a rehearsal with a local orchestra. But still, this day is a very special one.
I've got some good news for my wife and my family.
Today, Sean has finally received an important paper, his residence permit.
Congratulations, you made it.
Thank you. I've got the residence permit now.
Sean's friends also came to congratulate their mate. They have supported him for a long time along with his family. Now Sean can visit his relatives from the United States without any problems. Soon he will obtain his Russian passport. Aldar Tandim knows Sean quite well. They share the same hobby, throat singing. But at the moment, Aldar is helping Sean build his house.
There is still a lot of work to be done, making the roof and floor. And I also need to take care of all this slag and tar paper.
For Sean's children, this unfinished construction means more fun and more material to play with. Many sites in Tyva are considered sacred. One of them is the Aldin Bulak Mountains, near the Yenisei, 50 kilometers from Kizil. They are worshipped by throat singers. That's why Sean Quirk, the American who has learned Tyvan songs, and the members of the world-famous ethnic band Chegil Chin, including his friend Aldar Tandin, have come here. Their music is full of life. These sounds of nature are spreading across the pristine lands of the Tyva region. According to the oldest Tyvan tradition, to find an inner harmony, a person needs to build a temple, raise a family, and sing a song.